Father, thank you so much. The program is still this morning on ITV, and I did tell you that we're going to be looking at the state of the nation this morning, and security is going to be our special focus. And as we also make reflections to the issue of the Chibok girls, even after 5 years in captivity. And it's been a whole lot of discussions since 2014, talking about the Chibok girls. Federal government on their own part has made efforts, according to reports available to us, that federal government has made series of efforts to make sure that the remaining 112 girls are released. But as you all know, that the issue of insecurity or the issue of insurgency is something that it's so so very something that you really need to attend to with utmost care. So I think that's what the federal government is trying to do, to make sure that the remaining girls are being released. Well, even as we look at that and we say about that, about the federal government, let's also look at security in Nigeria. Now, on Friday, we understand that in Kaduna to be precise, why people went about their normal, duty, their normal day-to-day life activities, trying to catch phone, holiday resorting and all that, attackers came, invaded the Kaduri, resorts and opened fire on innocent people and killed. As a matter of fact, about three people are reported to have died in that attack, one of them a British, and two others, are still under captivity. And this has called for concern, not only for the Nigerian authority, but for the British authority, even to the extent that the United Nations had to call in and send their condolences to Nigeria and also to the British authority. Now, this has gone beyond Nigeria because our integrity as a nation is at stake here. So it's high time we begin to talk to ourselves so that we can put all this whole issue of insecurity behind us. Well, to discuss all this morning, looking at state of the nation and security in focus, and also Chibok girls, 5 years, reflections. We are so privileged to have Honorable Emmanuel Iyaoyuwa. He's an SA, a special assistant, SSC, a senior special assistant to the present governor, Governor Obaseki in Edo State. Sir, you're welcome to this program this morning on ITV. And also we have Mr. Kingsley Ose Obo, who is also a human rights, let me not introduce him as a human rights activist now, but I know he's a public, or a human rights activist.
Yes, definitely.
And also a public affairs analyst. Sir, you're welcome to this program this morning on ITV. All right, now let me come to Honorable Emmanuel Iyaoyuwa. Now, your government has been in the forefront in the fight of Boko Haram insurgency. As a matter of fact, before this administration came on in 2015, that was before the birth of the first regime, the first tenure, the fight against Boko Haram was one strong thing that this government talked about, and a lot of people actually voted for this government, believing that they will come on board and really fight the Boko Haram insurgency. But as we speak now, people say that it seems that this government is being overwhelmed by the Boko Haram insurgency, particularly in security situations in the country. I don't know if you agree with that.
Before I go on to answer your question properly, first and foremost, let me thank or appreciate our handsome brothers and beautiful sisters in the war front who are fighting to make sure that this country did not disintegrate. Even when we are enjoying our Easter holidays, they were there in the bush fighting for us. So I thank all of them. And I equally want to use this medium to express my condolence to all the families that may have been affected by these our security men and women that have paid their supreme price. And God should grant them the fortitude to bear the irreparable loss. Now to your question. You see, the issue of insecurity is almost becoming a global phenomenon, or a global phenomenon, as the case may be. It's not peculiar to Nigeria. That I know that to every serious government, both at the state, federal, and local, their primary function is the security of lives and properties. You heard what happened about 3 or 4 days ago in Sri Lanka, where about over 200 were killed in a multiple blast. And just yesterday, I shed my tears when I was watching the television and I saw the mass burial of those our good brothers and sisters. In fact, by yesterday it was confirmed that 301 have died and over 600 they are hospitalized. And only God knows the fate of some of those our brothers and sisters. So this is not peculiar to Nigeria, but for us to be concerned about our environment, I think I want to make it clear here, and I did it in some other fora, that Buhari, if not Buhari, by today, I don't believe you and I will be sitting here comfortably to talk in this studio. Why? Before that 2015, you are aware of several bombings in Abuja. You are equally aware that some money were earmarked to prosecute this Boko Haram, that is buying of sophisticated weapons. There was money earmarked to purchase these sophisticated weapons to be given to our security agencies in the front. But the money was shared by Nigerians.
Yeah,
I'm coming, sir. Hold on. I know what you're saying. I just want to let you understand. You actually said my government. Yes, I'm going to that area. I want to let you understand that Buhari has fared well. Buhari has, look, the issue of insecurity or war is an expensive venture that cannot be fought and won overnight.
Are you saying that Nigeria
Let me buttress my claims. Now, Buhari, he came, and if you can still recollect that some army officers were detained for not fighting properly, but Buhari came, released those people, and tell the army officers, the army leadership, that why are you quarreling with this? Why do you have to go and imprison these people when they were not given the proper weapon to fight Boko Haram? And let me let you understand, if this fight for Boko Haram has started, as at that time the money was earmarked during President Jonathan's era, I believe maybe by today we would have made some positive headway. So to Buhari or the government, you said, the government has actually tried. Government of Buhari, not even only Buhari. In Benin here, Edo State, our governor too, we can see Governor Obaseki. You can see how far he has gone in terms of security. He has even carved out an outfit that is known as Operation Wabaziga. And today, you see the cars everywhere doing some surveillance check in the town. Those are some of the steps, positive steps, that the APC government have made. That of Buhari, my dear, let me let you understand. Even your own home, you built your house, put fences and whatever it is, still it will be difficult for you to secure that place. You are talking of a whole nation. The best that man can do is to provide the money for whatever weapon that the army need to prosecute this war. You cannot do more than that. You can't go to the war front. So the leaders, the leadership of our agencies, they are equally trying. They are trying. I praise Buratai.
Now,
because the actions he's putting forward.
Yeah.
The action Buratai is putting forward is yielding positively.
Now, Honorable,
let me just land.
Yeah.
Now, when at a point all these bombings were taking place, you could imagine a president took a helicopter down to that. That shows how far he is concerned about the lives of Nigerians. The man is not playing. The only thing he can do is to provide. And he has done so in so many times. But that this war cannot be fought overnight. That's why I use your house as an
you
example.
You said he took an helicopter to where, to precise, sir, where did he go to? You just said that the president took a helicopter to one of the places that the bombings was taken out.
I think Kaduna, it is not the first time. He went to Kaduna, he went to Taraba to sympathize with the people. And he made his instruction to the army that they must go after these people and make sure they get them. And even when you kill them, that's not the but. Make sure these people are brought to justice.
Now, the reason why I'm asking this question is the president is the chief security
officer of
the country.
Yes,
I mean, he's the number one citizen. He's the CNC, the commander-in-chief of the armed forces.
Yeah.
What that means is that he gives his commands to the military, paraphernalias and all that, and they take obey and all that. Now, you talked about that before this time we had a situation that had to do with the former administration trying to procure equipment to fight insurgency and all that, and that came to no bear. But we also understand that even as this administration came on board, the Tucano jets that PMB bought, that was probably one of the first issues that he had with National Assembly. A lot of people thought that that after that the issue of insecurity will almost be a thing of the past. So what is really going on?
Now, let me let you understand one thing. When the Niger Delta militants were doing their thing. Let me see, use that word, their thing, fighting for their rights. They had a purpose, and Nigerians understood this purpose. They had something they were fighting for. The IPOB, they equally have something that they were fighting, and Nigerians seems to understand it. But these particular people, today you hear of Hesme, tomorrow you hear of Hausa, next tomorrow you hear of Fulani, the other time Boko Haram. These people, these particular groups that are doing this, that are perpetrating this dastardly act, they have no particular thing that they would put forward before the government and let the government understand, maybe to negotiate with them. They are just doing it. At a point, they said they don't like women education. At another point, they said when they kill as many people as possible, then they go to heaven. I mean, what kind of human being are these people? So the type of insurgency that is going on is not the type that the government, whether Buhari time, Buhari era or any other, can fight with a twinkle of an eye. It's not possible, because these groups that are just coming up, they just come up, you don't know what they are fighting, they don't say what they are fighting for.
Are you saying that this situation will linger on?
By the special grace of God, there is no beginning without an end. As far as our president is concerned, he has taken the bull by the horn to even push Boko Haram away from Sabisa. Sabisa used to be where they do their jamborees. But today, that place has returned to a sports arena. So the truth is that even in Iraq, since the death of Saddam Hussein, there are still bombings here and there. So there is no way, there's no intelligence that the government can put in place that will be able to forestall these insecurity matters within overnight. It's not possible. So gradually we are going. That was what I made an instance that before the 2015, there was bombings in Abuja, even some meters to the national stadium where the president was in attendance. So by now, I don't think, Mr. Uyi, you can correct me, I stand to be corrected,
Mr. Ever,
you have heard of any bombings in Abuja municipal since Buhari came to power.
But if not in
Abuja. No, excuse me, sir. I know what I'm saying.
Abuja,
that is
not,
how, no, we can't do it. We can't do all of them in one day.
Yeah.
Now that he has been able to contain them from coming to Abuja, they are only being contained from taking part of Nigeria. You know how many local governments were contained? I think about 17, 18.
Okay, now, let me pause.
So he has tried.
I will come to you much later.
Why has tried, my brother?
Now, Kingsley, I'll say, Obo, the insecurity situation in Nigeria is perhaps, complex, hydra-headed. You understand? You talk about the Boko Haram insurgency in the northeast, some parts of the northwest. Then, of course, if you come to the southwest, the southeast, south-south, you talk about armed banditry and all that. Now, some people have actually posited that the best way to actually fight all this is state police. Do you think that is what we need now?
Now, to continue in line with your discussion, I would like to just pick up from where he stopped, going by what he said. Let's not reduce our discussion when it comes to national discourse like this as important as security to image laundering and defending of, which has been one of the major problems of this administration. We want to pass blame, want to pass the buck, which my colleague here is already doing, trying to say that Buhari has done well. Nigerians are
well. He has his own opinion.
Nigerians, once we say a thing today, the country is so divided that we want to look at north-south dichotomy, want to look at partisan affiliation, want to look at religions, bias, and all that. That's how the country is. Drop it a topic now, anywhere on the street, and the first thing people want to look at is, who is this man from? The tribe and everything. And we give it that coloration, and soon we lose sight of what we should be focused on. Now, if you look at what we're talking about, when like you said, there's no bombing in Abuja. I think it would have been better than a bombing in Abuja, than the people in the villages are safe in their native land. Because if they're bombing in Abuja, I'm sure these people will sit up and do the right thing. But I'm not saying we should bomb in anywhere. Mm. But as it is right now, I'm happy the Minister of Agriculture just recently said, the food security insecurity will soon be on us because people no longer go to the farm. And he was still afraid to use the right word. He said, kidnappers. We all know these are Fulani headsmen. What's difficult in using hitting the nail on the head? And like he said, when you mentioned about Boko Haram had been driven from Sambisa Forest, driven to where? Into the hinterlands, into the country. Now, even here in Benin, even in Oluku, I'm sure there have been victims of Fulani herdsmen attack, whether it led to killings or whether property destruction or even just causing some level of uncomfortability, which happens around, day to day. So when you talk about it, it would be better if we were contained in Sambisa Forest so that the whole part of the country would be good. But you see, like what I find happen, what I see happening around us is the government comes and with insecurity, it's every part. We like to always borrow, look at the parts, the negative part.
Oh, but that's also a fact.
I agree.
It's not the economic boom.
The
Nigeria that is affected.
Economic boom, which actually fuels insecurity, is also taking part in that part of the world. Why don't you look at that? Why don't you say that? Why don't you talk about the issue of investment, favorable investment climate that happens in other parts, as little as not far like Ghana? Why don't we talk about the issue of power generation is going on? Why do we're always quick to say it's happening there? And this is what is related thing happened recently. I knew it very well that we're going to start hearing people say it's not peculiar to Nigeria. We should stop boring. In fact, I'm happy that at least there was one thing that the world came to want. They wanted to learn from Nigeria the way we tackle the Ebola crisis. The world said, how did you do it? I mean, it's a high time we start telling, even exporting things to the world and say, come learn from Nigeria how we are doing these things. Not all the time saying, it's not peculiar to Nigeria. I'll just digress a bit. I heard in the news one day that, I think Madagascar, one African country that had a cyclone or a natural disaster, and to describe how bad it was, they said, there was no power or water. That's how to describe how bad it was. And I laughed, because in Nigeria here, we don't have power. Just that there was power outage here. It's a normal thing. Even if you have power for the 24 hours in Nigeria, you wonder what's happening. Talk about water, it's a forgotten issue. We don't have a sink, a borehole in your house. So why do we, that's how bad it is in our country. I was outside this country not long ago, and a man asked me a question. An Indian man, he said, the news just went on and said, 17 people died in Afghanistan. 70 died in northern Nigeria and Kaduna. He said, what's happening to you in your country? I was ashamed when they asked that question. A country we know as bad as Afghanistan, 17 died, country at war. And in Nigeria, when we see there's no war, we believe or we claim there's no war, 70 died in one day. In Nigeria today, look, when you hear that 10 people died, it's like it's no news. That's the truth. People, not less than, I would say, over 50, 60, 100 at times die in this country. 150 died the other day, the president was out of this country. Now, I believe one thing, what actually is foiling this thing? I think I should go to that, like you're asking that question now. What's foiling this? Number one, it's not about buying Tucano jets, like they just now, the news is awash with, we just received Augusta helicopters. Yeah, Augusta helicopter, you now pray that should not be used to kill innocent citizens. The commander-in-chief, he's the commander-in-chief, planes were used to bomb IDP camp, people who ran from their home to take refuge in a camp. Planes till date. I've not really heard what happened about that. Not once, not twice. And so we're not given the right. Number two, now you look at the issue of Augusta jet now. Now that we've got, will that solve Boko Haram? No, that won't solve it. The Boko Haram issue, and what I mean, we'll let you the Chibok girls and what we find in the Fulani herdsmen, we find a government whose primary purpose is supposed to defend the people. Defending these people. I mean, why the president saying accommodate these people? Later he went abroad to say they were just people who were displaced by the Gaddafi, the death of Gaddafi. The president, we had the defense man also defending these people. We had the IG of police, former IG of police, media past IG of police, telling us that, look, they will not implement the law made by, law formulated by a state house for assembly.
But I will let you say that I don't think there has ever been a time that the president defended the Boko Haram.
You
can't say so.
Like I just told you.
You can't say
no,
so.
Mark my words. I didn't say defend the Boko Haram.
Okay.
I said the president went, to the UK and said, the killings in Nigeria are perpetrated by people, fighters who were displaced from Libya.
He said some of them are believed. Some of them are believed. I think
but the president is telling us how many have they apprehended and they confessed to that. That means he got intelligence report, right? How many have they apprehended and presented in the law court and they now confessed that, we are from Libya? Now, but when you come up and say, don't worry, you're telling the international community now, don't worry, those are people, it's not really our problem. They are killing your people. When I use the word defending, you ought to be saying, we've got so-and-so number, we put them here and here, and all that. Maybe if they come from they are Libyans actually, then they should be, the Libyan government should be asking, if there's a government, they should be asking us, oh, how do you, like we're asking Saudi Arabia to not to kill the lady that was recently killed over
the drug issue. Yeah.
Now, the president went abroad to say, these people, I mean, that means he got intelligence report, or he knows them, or he has seen them, or they've confessed to him. We didn't see all that, but what I heard, was that the president is saying, these people, not to worry, it's not a problem peculiar to Nigeria, but it was, look at what happened in Mali now. The people, they all resigned because of killings of over 100 persons. But here in our country, all the security chiefs want to stamp their foot. First, the president said they were our brothers, accommodate them. The president went to Jos and said, let's pray.
Yeah, but Kingsley, we also need to look at the achievements of some of these.
I agree.
I remember sometime in 2015,
yes.
Some local governments in Borno State, to be precise, yes. We had the Boko Haram had to hoist their flag.
Okay.
In some of these local governments, but now we don't have that. Okay. So
good.
That is
now, good. Now, you don't have them, but they've hoisted their flag in your farms. You may not be seeing physical, so people can go to farm. Now, because the Boko Haram or some of these, whatever you call them, I can't call them Boko Haram. I don't know exactly which. We have the different groups, the Boko Haram, from what we hear from the news, the bandits, the kidnappers, whatever. They all lead to insecurity. What I'm saying now, they may not be in Sambisa Forest. They may not be hosting a flat in the local government. When they were hosting flats in the local government or whatever, they were not killing everybody. They were just hosting a flat. Oh, we are now in charge of this place. And I don't give any no thanks to the former administration and some of the way they handled the things. But what I'm saying now in our farms, in our backyards, they hoisted their flag. So people can go to farm now, as even in Edo State here. I know, what is that village again that they've been calling on the government to help them?
You know, the...
Yes. I know one of a co-staff of mine, the mother, she obtained permission to go settle it because the mother can't go to farm, and they are now dragging a small piece of land close to the house. And that was the reason he was getting obtaining permission to go settle the matter, to speak for his mother.
Okay, now let me...
So that's the Boko Haram, in another way, or banditry, or kidnappers, or Fulani herdsmen in our backyard. So when you say they are no longer in Sambisa Forest, it wasn't this bad. It wasn't this bad. Yes, like, you see, the former president, Goodluck Jonathan, made something that startled me years ago. I can't forget because I remember where I was that day, and I think it was the army day or so. And he said, if you find anybody who is fighting against Boko Haram, jeopardizing your fight against Boko Haram, let me know. I would transfer him. I mean, that word hit me. Transfer a man fighting you? You will transfer? Of course, the problem of Nigeria is not tied to Muhammadu Buhari.
So what you're saying is before
it's been there, but what has happened now? What has happened now? It has been compounded.
Okay, now let me just hold on. I know you have something to add to what you just said.
Okay.
But let's look at it, in another way. Now, you see, each time we have all these forms of attack, like the most recent one in Kuduro in Kaduna State, where a British was killed. Now, we had the Honorable Minister of Information, Lai Mohammed, coming to commiserate and all that, and saying to Nigerians that the government is in top gear to make sure that they handle it. Now, for Nigerians, this is one story but too many. It's something that the government will always say. And the question that they readily ask is that perhaps this administration does not have the political will. I don't know whether this administration really has political will to really handle the situation at hand.
As far as I'm concerned, and to the best knowledge of what I've experienced all these years, you will remember that Chibok girls were kidnapped and taken away in 2014, April.
2014, yeah.
April
14th.
Yes, 14th before the precise. Advent of Buhari's administration. Were there no government at that time to make any headway? None of them was released. But when Buhari now came, it became a thorn in his flesh that this should not happen in his time. And he must make sure that these innocent girls are released. Forget about whichever way.
But even at that, we
excuse
had the Dapchi girls
excuse
too,
me, sir.
That
excuse
were
me,
also
sir.
Kidnapped
excuse
and taken away
excuse
in
me,
the
sir.
Same Buhari's administration.
Excuse me, sir. Yeah. We have a Bini adage that Ewi Rahiyama Okayu Uriyama Swen.
Yeah, but I understand that, but what we are saying,
hold on now.
Have been
you
lost.
Have asked a question.
But
let me answer it. Don't worry, let me
answer
it. I just want to draw your attention to the fact that the Chibok girls were not carted away in Buhari's time. But he has tried, he has put in effort, time, and energy to make sure that at least majority of these girls are released. It's see headway. Talk of Lie, today that is equally a world discussion all over the place. This man equally told them outside Nigeria that there is no way you cannot release that girl unhurt, but he's still going on with the negotiation. Let me let you understand. By the time you are negotiating with an opponent that's fighting you, you don't need to be too weak. Otherwise, if you do that, your opponent will take advantage.
Yeah, the issue is that even as the negotiation is going on about Lea Sharibu, about the remaining Chibok girls, the remaining Dapchi girls, now we still find series of attacks here and there.
Where I wanted to take from. That's what he said. In Odige. No, I don't want to be particular with any
in Odige is a known fact.
It's not only Odige.
Yes.
Now, what I want to say about that is this. You know, when I'm speaking like this, I always want to put my Benin Adish. Benin Adish has that. Audio we can get more than wage, we all these communities you are
seeing. Can we translate that now?
Yes, if a stranger knows where
the king is,
the king is buried in the community.
Yeah.
It is the information of the indigene. It is the indigene that will go and say, look at where the king was buried.
I'm coming. Technological aid.
I'm buttressing. You have your time. I'm buttressing my claim with that adage.
Yeah.
What I want to let you understand that all these communities, none of these people, whether Fulani, Esme, or whatever it is, can enter into any community without the connivance of those at the helm of affairs in that community. I'm telling the gospel truth. Before a herdsman takes his flocks to the field to graze, my brother, somebody in that community, one or two persons, are already behind the person.
Now,
excuse me, sir.
I think we also need
those
to establish something
those people,
here.
Excuse me,
now, we are looking at our nation.
Go on.
The country Nigeria. Now, as we speak now, there's no law that bans any Nigerian from living in any parts of the
quite
country.
Right.
As a northerner, you can go to the farthest south and live. Live all your life there. There's no law
but
that says that you can
evil.
Live. Yeah. So when you say, because I've heard that kind of discussion, that conversation in some other climes, that don't allow these people to come. Now, that should not be the kind of discussions that we should be talking about.
Excuse me, sir. Yeah. That is why I said a door has been opened to them.
Okay.
And they really need to go in. As in my own community, these people try to come. All the youth in that, they mobilized.
Which people are you talking about now? Are you talking about the
herdsmen? They are one of those people that are perpetrating evil.
Excuse me.
All the communities.
No, we cannot say that.
Why?
We can't make that general.
No, excuse me, sir.
I won't let you say
this
that.
This is an eyesore.
But we have some herdsmen that won't hurt a fly.
No, the issue is where one finger takes oil.
You can't
say that. The rest, my brother.
I know, but let us not generalize here.
Let me clear this point.
I need
some of them are living harmoniously with their community. Accepted. But the issue now is going beyond control.
So if you know that some
it's
of them live
control.
Harmoniously,
so it cannot be leveled to Buhari.
All right. So if you know that some of them live harmoniously, can we make such a general statement? Can we live with that general?
That is what
mindset?
I'm saying now. There is one thing, my brother. One of my uncle used to tell me: if you know what you cannot continue, don't start it.
Okay.
So long as they have been given that privilege to move in that area, somebody particular. It's not the people that own the community. Those who have a say in that are those that are always behind these people.
Please, can,
so what I'm saying is that. In my own community, I made an example. In my own
which community?
They were coming. Igwobo.
Okay, Igwobo.
You know, Via Notice.
Okay,
yes.
Okay.
These people were coming with their flocks. The youth mobilized that they should not come into that area. They are not driving them from any other place, but within that community. Because why not along the road? To come at the border, that's where they feed, that's where they train their children. So I'm not saying all the communities, but the government, I must not fail to say this, the government, it is high time the government tried as much as possible to create a place, a ranch for these people to carry out their daily
activities. But the federal
government. By the time you leave there to move around uncontrolled, several things are bound to happen. You cannot imagine a farmer having brushed, planted, clearing, and be doing all the time, energy, and money, then he's coming to the farm in the morning, or no person leaves his cows and cattle into the farm, ravage the whole place. He cannot be happy. That's such a person. Cannot be happy.
Now, Kingsley Yoselbo, when the issue of Boko Haram started, just hold on, when it started, you know, analysts were really trying to analyze the costs, you know, some of the fundamental causes and all that. Some say that it was politically motivated.
Yeah.
Some say that it was economically motivated. Yeah. Some say that it was as a result of low education in some parts, to be precise, in the north part of the country.
Yes.
And some say that some people, out of wickedness, so to say, they just decided to unleash terror. Now, I remember the then governments of Goodluck Jonathan really started to see how they can really find a lasting solution. But before we knew that, government was put in abeyance.
Okay.
Now, as it is now, it appears the situation is complex.
Good.
So where do you think this government can really start?
Yes, you see, like he said, let me go for, I'd like to pick from where he stopped again. You, going by his African adage he's been making, there's this one I know, that's when they asked a madman, why did you set fire in the bush? He said, the fire that's there now, the forest that's aflame, is not, doesn't know what, the little one he's stuck here,
is
one
he
knows
aware
about.
Of, yeah.
You know, that he can, talk about. So if you look at what the president, Muhammad Buhari, when he got in and he made that statement of the 97%, 5% dichotomy, it's one thing you must trace. So, like I just mentioned, now you traveled abroad and you say, look, this thing, try to play down the situation in the country. You find countries like what's happening in Sri Lanka now. The president is crying out. What happened in Christchurch, Australia?
Mm.
The prime minister cried out. But in Nigeria, what we find, you're talking about the British woman that's been recently killed.
Yeah.
We're only hearing that because there was a foreign national involved. In Nigeria, like I tell you, people die in their tents, in their hundreds daily. We don't hear it. We don't even in national news. It's played down. When you hear a man in power, a man who ought to be the one crying out and saying, the former IG of police, who ought to police the country, telling you that I will not implement a law that was passed by, legitimately passed by the State House for Assembly, because it does not favor a group. When you find the letter, he apologized. First he said it was a communal clash. You remember that? The letter went and apologized. He came on air. The president gave him a directive to be there. The man didn't go. We heard from the president's mouth. I don't want to going by hearsay. I'm talking about things that you can verify. And said, I asked you to be in the place. And the man still served and was even extended. Whether by one day or by one hour or not. That man should have been fired. A presidential directive was flouted and the man is still working. What do you call that? There will be a ripple effect. If the IG can do that to the president, the DPOs will do the same thing. If you give instruction, there's going to be, look, you don't wait to hear killings. Actually, security is not until you rush, like we do in Nigeria here, a fire brigade approach. We always want to be reactionary in our things. We ought to plan. Look at what I see in Benin now. If you notice, I first started seeing these boys who clean windscreens. Yeah, they are margaries. I started seeing them at near Ring Road. Later, they moved down to Akpakpava, and I see them now, began to see them at the traffic light first junction. Later they moved to Downsing Junction. Now they are moved to Urubi, Iyaro. Now they are not Solusia. You meet them there. Now they've crossed now beyond Solusia towards after the Ulua Primary School. That should tell a wise man what's happening. These boys are, you see boys about 10 years old boys cleaning your windscreen. Tomorrow there was one I saw one day and it was, taunting at me and telling me if I don't allow you to give my whiskey. Then what happens when this guy's 20 years old?
No,
10 years from now.
No, Kingsley, wait.
Listen, where I'm driving at this, you don't tackle security or these issues when it happens. You look at things. We're taught, like we talk about in elementary school, you plot a graph and interpret the graph and say, at this point, this will happen. You can project. The Boko Haram team, we should have known all this while, with the issue of bets. Great. People are giving birth to no parental care, no love shown to them. They are thrown into the street. We should have known that. So the Boko Haram said, like you said, is multifaceted because economically these people had nothing. I was in Kano in the 90s, and I heard about the Amajiris, and we sat to eat on the highway. You could see how these people swarm around us. If you threw a spoon of rice, no one would drop to the ground. They are supposed to be from parents, but you won't find that this in the south. But we knew what was happening in the 90s.
We understand. We understand the paradigms. We understand all those narratives. Now,
I am telling you that the Boko Haram issue started. And there could be another Boko Haram in Edo State. Mm. If we don't. Look, Good Lord Jonathan did something. He built Amajiri schools. That's a good point. Educate these people, because a man has nothing, no love, nothing, no parental care. You give him a gun and say, go kill that man for Some small patches, some, he will do it.
And of course, this administration has also tried well.
The homegrown feeling, right?
Yes.
Can we take a walk back to a primary school or this school across and know how many people have been fed?
Do you know the problem, one major problem
with this administration, let me tell you. Two major problems with this administration. And I would say, those states under the APC administration, and I'll say, I'm proud with what I've seen the governor Obaseki done so far.
Okay.
Yes. Now he tells you, I'm going to do this. He's taking touting a little off the street. He's not associating, openly with the
Agri-Touts
and all that. That's something. Mm. He's telling you go back to school. He's putting the right people. I'm seeing people who are learned people coming into his government. Now, what do you find in the federal situation, for instance? The president says one thing. You find out he's not speaking the truth. The other day, he said he's commissioned a dam. Look at what he said now recently the UAE that Boko Haram has been completely wiped out. He said so. Look at what he said. When the government, like you said just now, a government says they're saying the issue of our rights. The rights is everywhere. We now have rights. When you can no longer trust what a man says.
But you also need to understand something. Yes. He may have insinuated that based on where we're coming from.
No.
Really, before 2015, the issue of locally produced rice was almost a forgotten issue.
In my own opinion.
But if you go to market these days, you will find homegrown rice.
You find where? You find homegrown rice.
And how much in our market?
How much is it sold?
Well, for about 13, 14,000 a bag.
And when last did you buy that? Look, you see one thing like you mentioned. Yeah. When we say things like this, we have enough rice to feed, we have this. Look, all I'm telling you, I'm not going to deal with all rice. I've not said we have verifiable facts.
If you go to our market today,
I agree.
If you doubt me, go to Busha Street.
I agree. I'm not telling you.
Locally produced rice, you will find them there.
When you start having locally produced rice today, even as a young kid, I used to have here Ekpoma rice, Agbede rice, Ilushi rice, I've heard of those things. All I'm telling you is this. When you have a government in place, when I hear that word excellency, I feel it should be excellent in all you say. You should mind what you say and how you say it as a leader. When a leader comes and is flippant and he says things you cannot verify, or you find that this man has said, even your child, if you tell your child I'm going to buy you a biscuit and you come back and you don't buy that child biscuit, once white rice, he's going to start doubting you. So what we are saying, this government is quick to pass the blame. In 4 years, like he said, we are still coming. In 4 years. This government is quick to pass, this thing happened, the cheaper gas issue. I agree. It's an unfortunate situation that happened. But 276 guests captured, over 100 still in captivity, is a small sum compared to the numbers that are killed on a daily basis in this country. Kidnapping is no longer news in Nigeria. It's no longer news in Edo State. And I don't expect to blame the governor on that, because he's doesn't control. None of the security apparatus, like what happened in Zamfara State. The man said, I'm willing to resign. And I saw a lady recently, one of your colleagues, broadcaster, blaming the governor. I think the word he used, a harsh word on the governor. The governor does not control the army, control none of the armed forces. You are blaming him over killings. Now we're not hearing the issue of it's caused by the airmen who are supporting banditry. Look, it's like when I heard about Goodluck Jonathan saying, I have Boko Haram in my government. And I wondered, what do you want me to do if you're the commander-in-chief? If you've got the intelligence report, then fish them out and put them where they belong. In the same way, let's not reduce our talk on security as important security to partisanship. Let's speak the truth, because it affects every one of us. I'm not defending APC or PDP here. I'm speaking for the average nine. I'm speaking for myself. Those days, you could travel freely. Going between a 300 kilometer now from Benin to Lagos, you're afraid. I was going to travel one day. In fact, we all know this. You don't go on flashy cars these days because you are afraid to go on flashy cars. A man told me, I can't drive in my Jeep because I could be a target. And that's the truth. We all live in fear.
Okay. Well, let's look at the other topic that we slated.
Just before you go, let me quickly
introduce the other topic because of time. Now, I did say that we're going to be looking at the issue of the Chibok girls, reflections after 5 years. On the 14th of April 2014 was actually the day that these school girls in their teens, 14, 15, 16, they were captured in government secondary school in Chibok in Maiduguri and taken to unknown destination. And lots of actions, reactions, accusations and all that trailed that, kidnapping, so to say. And it's been something that Nigeria as a nation has not been happy about. And we've also seen some people, you know, that have made their protests known over these 5 years that this girl should be released and all that. But good enough, this government, the APC government, made efforts to release some good numbers, reducing the numbers of the girls now to 112. But the remaining girls are still in captivity. So I don't know. What do you think the government can do now so that these girls can be
released? Just the wrong statement.
Which wrong statement?
Let me answer that. Let me quickly. Yeah. When you say the APC government has done, no. It's wrong.
No, let me, sorry, Evans, you're also human.
I feel that, like I said, security, matter of security, there's some issues. Security is one of them. That we should not make it, the Chibok gas issue is still, was fueled by the same partisanship thing, PDP, APC. If you heard what happened about that, the president even came out to say he was not told, was not informed, even after, for a long period of time, so he couldn't even act, that the government in place, that was an APC government. Look, that's not him. The girls who are victims today.
The president was not told what?
Yeah, they were good journalists, and the presidency said they were not informed. Happened about the kidnapping. They were not informed when it happened, that it took some days or so. Okay. I can't really remember. Before they were told. Okay. And there was a government in place.
Let me answer the question.
I said something that this government has done well. Now the point is,
don't mention the APC. That's what I'm saying.
Yes, APC has to come in.
No.
It is the government in power.
When you say
APC is not the responsibility of securing this country now. You can't blame PDP. You can't blame APC.
Now, gentlemen,
the very political party in power to APC.
The government is the hold on. Now the point is,
it's APC.
Whether we like it or not. These girls, was a certain number released, yes or not?
I mean, within this administration?
In this administration.
Yes.
Yes.
So what I was saying?
Brokered by the ICP, the International Committee for the Red Cross.
Listen, the question you asked, my brother, is what do we do?
To make sure that the remaining girls are released?
We thank God for the life of our brothers and sisters in the war front. They have tried. I will continue to start from there. Now, there is no way that this issue of insecurity can be fought and eradicated completely. So what the government should do, according to your question, is this.
But it is the concern of the average Nigerian to be fought and eradicated.
Excuse me, sir.
Yeah,
of course. Let's go to your question. The question is, what can the government now do?
Yeah.
Yes, the issue has arisen. Definitely we must try to make sure that we come out of it anytime. Because I don't want it to prolong longer than this. Because Nigerians, I'm not happy. I won't tell you lies. I'm not happy with the way some persons are being sent to untimely grave in Nigeria. And what the government should do, Buhari has started it, is the chief commander of the armed forces. His own is to give directive. Weapons are being provided. Incentives are provided to boost the morale of the security agencies. It is the right of the security agencies to secure this country, like as I said before, from disintegrating. Now, I want to lend my voice with those Nigerians who have advocated for community policing. Community policing is very, very proper and is timely in Nigeria now. Because I reside at Tuselu. We are now in Igusa. It is only the people here in Igusa that will know what is happening. In Igusa, they know the outcomes. They know the nooks and crannies.
Yeah.
But me in Uselu cannot know it.
So that's not
excuse
true.
Excuse me, sir. I'm coming.
It's not always true.
We need
the U.S.
Coming,
sir.
I'm coming, sir.
It's intelligence.
Let me tell you, if you bring that issue of U.S. into this matter, it will look as if we are not discussing.
Nigerians will also know. I'm just giving us an example, judging
from the life. I mean, from the time U.S. has put in democracy, we are just nowhere. So I still want to believe that we are still growing. This democracy is nascent. It's still nascent.
I think the PD should let us see the pictures. Hold on. Some of the pictures of the Chibok girls. We are looking at Chibok girls' reflections after 5 years. Let's see some of the pictures so that we keep this memory in our mind and refresh them, and so that government will really do the needful. So that these girls can be released. Let's see some of the pictures of the Chibok girls. All right, back to you.
Yes. Now, what I want to say in effect is that our security agencies, they should be proactive. Because what happened in Sri Lanka, if I want to quote the president said And information reached them before this time that such a thing was going to happen, but not to that level. And the security agencies just relaxed and took it by wave of hand. So I think Nigeria security agencies now should not take proper correction. They should correct themselves now. They should be alive to their responsibility. They should be reactive. They should be proactive. Whenever there's an information, take it seriously and fight it. Because if they are saddled with responsibility of securing this country, Buhari is not an army. Our wait and see government is not an army. There are people who are paid.
Honorable, excuse me, sir, with taxpayers' money,
to carry out all the security.
Do you know my responsibility
issues?
Here? My responsibility is to ask the question that the viewer out there is watching now that cannot be here to ask.
Oh, okay.
Now, when you say Buhari is not army, Buhari is the CNC.
Good.
Excuse me, sir.
That was what I said. Yeah. I said he can only give directive.
So what is
not
going
to
happen?
The directives are not the
directives are not
going to Buhari will lead to the
instruction. Hold on, yeah.
It is because of this instruction that I say Buhari should always give out to the security agencies.
Give out what?
I mean instructions.
Yes,
instructions of how they should fare whenever all these issues of insecurity takes place. And the only, excuse me, sir, the only thing that can be done by the leaders of these security agencies is to be proactive. I've said it before. Whenever you hear any information, treat it and make sure you dispatch it properly instead of waiting for it to happen. So our security agencies, they should learn to be proactive and not reactive.
You see, now, do you think our security is being politicized?
You see, like Evans, let me just give me time to tie up some loose ends here.
Yeah.
First, like I mentioned, when I said don't mention the APC or PDP or whatever party, because of this partisanship thing, way we view things, ethnic coloration, tribal thing, that's who we're getting things wrong in this country. It's the truth. Now, if you say the APC government has released this, then if I'm the PDP, that's not the only party we have, but let me say I'm the PDP, and I have 20 of them behind me, you think I want to release them? I wouldn't want to release them, because you're going to give the credit to the APC. I'm not speaking here for the APC or PDP. If we must solve some very important problem in Nigeria, that's where I say I put the bulk of the blame on the president, the incumbent president. Look, as a president of the, after electionary, as a candidate, when you become president, you become a rallying point for all the over 300 ethnic groups in Nigeria. The point when you come and you make comments or statements that would flare up, and that's why I give the parable, when you ask the madman, why did you set fire in the forest? He said he just struck a match. I'm saying the president of Nigeria, there are statements that are credited to him that makes people wonder. Now, you just mentioned about giving instructions. The president was not in the country, went on medical tourism, like we've even heard recently. President Buhari holds the record of the president who has stayed longest out of the country. I just told you here, this administration has two problems. They say, we begin to doubt them. Recently, he's condemning that is wrong. Then you ask him, man, you just made this statement, you hold this record. Number, that's it. Then the issue about coming, he came from such medical tourism, and he spoke against IPOB. Set up a military unit, what do you call it? Python dance. And they went to the east. No mention was made about Fulani herdsmen. You call those people, the government was quick to tag the IPOB a terrorist group.
But we also had the Operation Lafayette Dome.
Well, listen now. I'm telling you, the president and the commander in chief.
And we have
he came from outside the country, and there was this so much talk, so much built up, in the east.
All right,
and the president spoke about the east.
Yeah.
Why didn't he speak about the Fulani herdsmen?
You said we should not level ourselves in any discussion to ethnics or.
No,
you are doing it here now.
You
are
doing it here.
Listen, you are saying because Buhari is a Fulani man, that is why all these people are here from.
No, I'm telling you what you said. You only give it. It should just give it to
If you believe that Buhari is the president of this country,
yes,
and the chief of
I know.
And you are saying when we are talking about insecurity now, we should not talk about APC. Is why not an issue?
My problem is that okay.
Everything that is done now,
yes,
is on the shoulder of APC.
Now we don't have time.
APC.
I'm done.
If it is bad, it's APC.
Oh, no, no,
APC has said
no. No,
they are the federal and the local government and the state level.
They have tried. They are federal.
You know, these discussions are open and they are ongoing. Some other time we should be
just for them to improve,
so that we can continue. Because of time, we really cannot do more now. A very big thank you to Honourable. Please extend a handshake to Kingsley.
Thank you,
Kingsley, you almost made me a guest.
Well, I just wanted to put this in the right perspective.
I'm the presenter here.
I'm sorry about that.